Welcome back, aspirants, to the Aurora IS YouTube channel. We continue the ecology and environment lecture series today with a discussion on ecotone, edge effect, ecocline, ecological niche, biome, biosphere, and the most important concept of ecological succession. So before I start this session, there's a reminder of the personal guidance program by an experienced mentor like Aurora sir, who will be able to guide you step by step in the process of achieving your dream goal of UPSC examination, clearing the examination with the daily timetable, with the individual timetable, as well as giving you all the kinds of material that is required with prelims and mains focus that will enhance your answer writing as well as your personality development through a one-on-one doubt clearing session via phone calls, and lots of materials, mini tests, monthly tests with mind maps kind of techniques that could enhance your memory so that you could perform well in your examinations. What that's require in UPSC preparation is the kind of a strategy laid preparation that will make you sure to crack it, and which is possible with a well-guided program such as the PGP program. So this program you can always contact on the details on these numbers as well as the mail ID. For further details, please contact on these below mentioned details. So let's quickly begin with the definition of ecotone. What's the concept of basic concepts of other ecology wise? So the first one is in ecology. Before reading the slide, let's check out the example diagram where you can see in this picture on the left side, there is some vegetation where trees, plants, and big trees and plants are available. And on the right side, you have some marshy lands, a grounded land where some of the watery substances are seen here. And there is a transition. This line will show you a transition towards a small area where little shrubs and little small plants are available. And the transition from this line is totally different to a marshy land. So this transitional area is the ecotone, which has a lots of abundance of a kind of a productivity or a biodiversity. So let's now go into the definition is what an ecotone is all about. It's a transitional area between a two diverse ecosystems. Diverse ecosystems in the sense, this is one of the ecosystem mentioned here, which is an upland vegetation where it is on the terrestrial in the elevated positions. On the other hand, it's a marshy area on the low level. So this is the area which is between two diverse ecosystems, and it acts as a junction between the terrestrial and marine ecosystems. Like for example, freshwater and marine ecosystems, between the river and the riverbank, as well as between the grassland and the forests and deserts and lagoons on the other side. So there is two contrasting, when there are two contrasting vegetation or the ecosystems, between that portion when there is a transition to it, that is known as ecotone. Let's understand with another better example, that if you see this area is inhabited with lots of big and long trees on the either side, and this will gradually change to a zone where small plants, when it will just get into a marshy area and finally into a aquatic ecosystem. So you see the aquatic and the terrestrial ecosystem, there is a transitional area between both of them. This and this area between that, we have an ecotone zone on the either side. So this is an ecotone. What are the characteristics? These have an overlapping boundary regions, because these are a boundary regions between two diverse ecosystems. They can be narrow as well as wide, depending upon the kind of area they are habitating with. And they have a lot of rich of biodiversity, because being in between two diverse ecosystems, they possess the nutrients, they possess the kind of biodiversity, floral or faunal, with lots of variety. That is why there is a rich biodiversity, where that thus, when there is a lots of biodiversity, there will be also density, like the number of organisms or number of species or number of plants present per unit area will be greater. And then if they are very sensitive to climate change, because having lots of species, the nutrient cycles, the biogeochemical cycles need to be in a balanced form. When we have some human induced changes, then this is a zone of tension, because these areas biodiversity will easily get affected with any kind of an external action. Let's come and understand more importance to the ecotones. Why is it important? Because we already dealt with it, like there are lots of diversity of organisms, there is a gene flow in the sense, the kind of of genetics diversity in a particular area or from one community another, there is a bridging between two communities. So the bridge, this bridge itself has a lots of flow of organisms. It is not devoid of vegetation. It will have vegetation that will be more rich in vibrant biodiversity. And then it's a buffer zone between any neighboring ecosystem. That is why there is a environmental damage can happen to this, and this will be the first biodiversity to get affected. That is why ecotone plays a very important role to be preserved with. There can be mangrove forest in such an area where ecotones exist. Thus, the from tsunamis and any kind of environmentally damaging natural hazards that occur, this wetlands or these kind of an ecotone areas can help in absorbing the shocks of the nature. And then these are always the natural indicators, because these are the first one, these are very ecological sensitive, that gets affected first in any kind of human induced or naturally induced external aggressions. And then ecoline, this is a zone of gradual but continuous change from one ecosystem to another when there is no sharp boundary between them. Like an ecoline occurs when there is a gradient, when there is an altitude, temperature factors, salinity, depth. All these factors when occur at a particular area, let's understand through an example, diagram itself. If you see this diagram itself, there is a transition from other one ecosystem to the other different type of ecosystem. But what happens is, as the definition says, that if you see, it's a gradual but continuous change. It will continue from one ecosystem another, but there is no sharp boundary. You cannot define a line in this diagram that where the ecosystem is completely changing onto a different ecosystem. So that portion is called an ecoline. So this is what another concept. So let's get into the other concept, small concept in ecology, which says the edge effect. Edge effect is nothing but an organism which occurs primarily in a zone abundantly. That is an edge effect. Like suppose in a terrestrial ecosystem, birds will be in more in number. So that is an edge. These are called the edge species. Density of the birds will be greater in such a transitional ecosystem, and that those species are called as edge species. And that kind of an effect on the biodiversity is known as the edge effect. So an edge is a boundary interface, which is also the ecotone. And when this kind of a species, population or a community change occurs in such kind of an ecotone area, that is an edge effect. So if you see this, this is the for edge effect, where on other side we have a concrete jungle and on the other side we have green jungle. So the light, wind, predators, all these kinds of external factors will influence this kind of an edge system, will improve or will increase the kind of species that dominate that region, which is the edge effect. Like if you see there are squares here, there are circles here. When the zone, ecotone, this is a zone, right? This is one of the ecosystem. This is another kind of ecosystem. To make your understanding easier, that is why this diagram is taken. Suppose this is an elephant or these are the leopards. So when there is an ecotone, this is completely like two different ecosystems, where the ecotone will be having lots of species from the other regions as well as its own ecosystem species also it will consist. But which species are more in number? If you see, there are lots of triangles as well as the squares from this region. So this is an edge effect phenomena, where some species will dominate more than the others. Then we'll come to the ecological niche. Ecological niche is what is an ecological niche and how is it different from an habitat. Let's understand niche. Niche is nothing but a functional role. See, suppose you are residing at one place. You are living in Old Rajanagar or Mukherjee Nagar. So that becomes your address. Okay. Means you are not performing any kind of an activity. You just exist in one location. That is your habitat. When you start functioning from your address, like when you start printing some books from your own place, or when you start some carpet business, or any kind of an Amazon, if you become a seller at the Amazon, or you start some kind of an activity, you have a functional role at your habitat. That is ecological niche. Niche is very unique to species. Like, see,
In your locality itself, you can see there will be lots of businesses. Some laundry business will be happening. Some departmental stores will also exist. So each of the ecological niche, each of the functional area role of a species in an ecosystem will be different from the other. So it is a very unique, such that no two species will have the same niche. That is important, and it's an important role in the conservation of the organisms, because every species will have its own unique function. That is why any kind of an activity like poaching or any disturbance to their ecosystem will cause a damage to the ecological niche also. Let's understand with this example in the diagram. You see these two ants are in a different direction, trying to push the material they have obtained for future consumption. So this is their habitat. This is where they are pushing that material to their habitat. But what is happening, the other ant has adapted towards the pushing factor, that it understood that pushing in front way will never, they'll never able to push it in a forward manner. So it will turn behind and push it ahead. That is why it is maintaining some kind of a functional role. It is collecting the food. It is pushing that material to in the opposite direction so that it will be easier for her to transport it to a distance. So that is a functional position of an organism, which will include its habitat, where it will reside. It will have some activity of pushing it, and it will have some resources also that will it will obtain. The resources, this food. So this combinedly is called the ecological niche. What is the importance? Why do we have to? If suppose we don't conserve, what will happen? Because see, niche is nothing but there are various species in a region. Every species has its own functional role. Functional role in the sense, every species will have its own profession. Let us understand it through very basic definition. Like niche is nothing but your profession. Habitat is nothing but your address. So niche, when you have some profession, you have a vital role in the society. So the same way they have these, the species when they are having some ecological niche, they play a very vital role in the conservation, and they will maintain the stability, stable coexistence in the different species of for community. Ecological niche. There are some people coming from this side, like some organisms coming from the other, one side, the other side. These organisms are more in number than this. So what these people feel is, let's get displaced to another region, so because this is very complicated. When they start occupying, there is a kind of a congestion, and there is a kind of a competition in this area when these two participants come and occupy this area. So they are pointing towards a functional role in some other kind of an address. So that is an ecological niche. And there are various types of ecological niche, like the habitat where one organism or the species lives. There is food where one eats and decomposes and species will compete with each other. There is reproductive niche, is how and when one species will reproduce. Physical and chemical niche, which is depending upon the temperature, land shape, land slope, humidity and other physical factors. Realized niche is which a species will occupy only, occupies a part of a niche where it is actually wanted to play a ecological niche or a functional role. So these are the different kind types of niche. And what comprises the niche, which we already dealt with the ant example. In the ant, you see, you have a habitat. It has some food that is bringing, resource that is bringing from the outside. It is adapting to the environmental condition by turning its legs in a backward manner to push the food into its habitat. And it has a relationship with the other species around it and within its own community as well. So that these are the components of the niche. Characteristics of which will become redundant, I'll just quickly glance it through. Like these species will find how adaptable they are into the location. They'll have a life history, habitat, as well as food chain importance. They'll interact with the other species, as well as having a physical and chemical niche. They will be affected by the temperature, rainfall, soil, availability of food. That will have an effect or influence on the niche. Now, until now, we have already dealt in the previous session also individual, population, community, ecosystem as well. So now we'll see something about the biome and the biosphere. That is what we are left with. Now, biome, what is the difference between the ecosystem and a biome? Biome is something like, from this diagram itself, you can understand. Biome is an extensive, large area compared to an ecosystem where you have multiple organisms or multiple species of the same genetic or gene flow. If you see, there are some mollusk or some mushrooms or any kind of plants or fishes, everything you see, there are more number and it is experiencing over a vast area. That is a biome. And biosphere is when your atmospheric, lithospheric and hydrological as well as the other environmental setup is combined. When the buildings and the aquatic ecosystem, everything is combined, that is the biosphere. So let's understand through these slides, like, what is a biome? Is there only the terrestrial part, which is divided into various regions that will have some kind of a vegetation, like it will have some deciduous, will have some temperate, different kinds of forests, and then animal and soil type will be different. No two biomes will be alike, because a desert biome, or if you compare with a temperate biome, they're totally different with a different kinds of a chemical or the physical setup. They will have a climate that will determine how these plants and animals will exist in the biome. For example, a desert biome, we will have a sporadic rainfall with very low humidity, like it will be very hot, and in the days and nights at the will be very cold. Something flora like cactus, fauna like reptiles and small animals and birds will exist in that location. So that is a biome. For example, see this desert biome, you have some cactus or cactic or xerophytic vegetation, you have some rocks, lots of wind erosion, aeolian vegetation will occur here. And then we'll come, after having discussed all these levels of organization, we are left with the biosphere. What's a biosphere? Biosphere is a junction where you include the atmosphere, the hydrosphere and the lithosphere. Lithosphere in the sense, the ground conditions where the stones and the land will occur. Atmosphere, air, hydrosphere, water. This junction is a biosphere. Is nothing but a Greek word, bios, meaning life, and sphaera, which is sphere. That's a narrow layer around the earth's surface that where the life will exist. That is why it's also called the zone of life, with vast network of interconnected systems. Why is it interconnected? Because it has atmosphere, hydrosphere and lithosphere. They are interconnected. And then the energy that is required, why the energy that is required comes from where? It comes from the sun. So that comprises a biosphere where green plants will prepare food from the sun energy. And the food chain will continue. And what's the food chain and food web and all that? In the next session, we'll be anyway discussing it about. How this, let's first understand the biosphere has origin. Like it first, it was coined by in 1875 by a geologist named Edward Suess, where he defined it like the place where a life will exist, that is biosphere. It is 3.5 billion years ago. It is the earliest forms with single-celled organisms like bacteria that survived without oxygen, were the first single-celled organisms that have existed on the Earth's surface. And later, when these organisms and in the kind of multiple-celled organisms, like which are also called the prokaryotes, have utilized the sun's energy from the external carbon dioxide, started preparing their own food, the life on the biosphere had started to exist. So that is the biosphere origin. Importance is zone of life, shelter and food, self-regulating water cycles, nutrient cycles, nutrition balance, different cycles, everything. This you can understand in a better way when you just continue the series. With the next session, I'll be dealing all these portions, like what are the water cycles, nutrient cycles, and how it happens in an ecosystem. That is an importance. And next we come to the last concept, which is a very important concept of ecological succession. Ecological succession is nothing but a process where a change or a replacement of some or the other ecosystem is happening. Just understand the change and a replacement. These two words are very important. It will not occur in single day or overnight. It will take lots of years, thousands of years in fact, where each community, it will be harder for it to survive, because the concept of Charles Darwin, who says that survival of the fittest. If you want to survive in this UPSC game, you have to be the fittest by having the right strategy and the knowledge to hit out the bull's eye of UPSC examination. The same way, if the community has to survive, it has to have the ability to adapt and to compete with the other organisms. So in the same way, if you see the ecological subsistence is nothing but the same diagram will explain it to you. Initially, there are small plants here with not that much of grass over it. In the next level, there are some grasses and all. The trees are trying to grow a bit. The shrubs or the bushes, small bushes are trying to grow a bit. And these have grown a lot of a bit. And after that, in the next level, after some 1,000 years, there are long and very tall trees with different kinds of leafy structure. And then after 1,000 years, we see the trees have extended with a dense vegetation where the leaf structure is very broad as well as very thick and dense. And then in the last stage, if you see, there are some other coniferous kind of a trees where the color of the leaves are different. They are turning the colors in the seasons. So this is a continuous change and replacement. You go into the next level after every 1,000 or 500 years, you find some other vegetation is replacing the previous one. So that is why it is called a succession. Succession, in other words, let's suppose there is a succession in your family also. That you have seen your generations, right? Like your grandfathers, their parents, and then your parents, and then next your generation. So this is a succession. Every generation is trying to replace the previous generation. The same way, succession is nothing but you have a primary succession, which is the first one. Primary in the sense, the first and the foremost one with small shrubs and all that. Then it started to grow, and a big trees have been formed. That is a secondary succession. Now there is a concept like in a secondary succession, when it will come, suppose there is some kind of a change in the environment where the soil nutrients is increased, or any through any kind of pollination, there have been new seeds coming up in the area. So then there can be a secondary succession where it is replacing the previous one. And this can also reverse it. Like suppose there is a deforestation or a forest fire which have occurred in recently in Amazon fires, then all of these area which is affected by a forest fire will again get back to the shrubs area. So with a catastrophe, it can lead to a primary succession, with a succession where the different kinds of environmental factors can enhance it, replace it with a secondary succession. That is an important of an ecological succession. For your better understanding, I have included two more pictures for your understanding that annual plants have been replaced with perennial plants and grunts, then shrubs, then we have pine trees, then we have hardwood trees with time. So the ecological succession is nothing but there will be series that will lead to a climax community. So in this diagram itself, this is a pioneer stage. Pioneer in the sense of first and the foremost, which is also the primary succession. The last one is called the climax succession. And every stage, there are different types of vegetation that is replacing. So these stages are called as seri or seral stages. So that is what we'll discuss here. See, succession stages or series. And then pioneer is the first plant community that will occur. And the final stage is called the climax community. And the shifting of nutrients, increasing the diversity, increasing the niche capacity, gradual increase in the competition and complexity of the food cycle at that location will have a change in the ecological succession. So the primary succession, if you see, it is devoid of lots of vegetation. You find some kind of a mountain or rocky structures with small shrubs and plants here and there. Whereas in the gradual succession, in the later times, in the climax stage, you can see totally grown up, well grown up trees. Before that, you can see there are some plants and everything coming up which are trying to replace this area. So this differentiates between the primary and secondary succession. The first primary succession is nothing but these are the first colonized species like the microbes or lichens or mosses that will have over a few generations. They will start to develop and grow and with the lots of trees and bushes coming up. They have a new conditions that enables the new organisms to survive. Then they have when they have a death or a decay, that is when it leads to a secondary succession. So the primary succession is also like the species will disappear as there will be a change in the vegetation with the invasive species or the change in the nutrient cycle or the biogeous chemical cycles. So all in all, we have already discussed in the diagram itself. So you can just pause the video and just glance through the slides as well. Then the secondary section is nothing but when the area is disturbed, and a climax community is the last stage of this secondary succession. Secondary successions can always get back to a primary succession when a catastrophe occurs. Then the grasses will be soon changed to a tall herbaceous plants, and then it will dominate with lots of animals, floral and faunal species as well. And over the years, a kind of a forest community only builds up. The community which has started with small grasses and bushes will turn up to a big forest community. That happens in secondary succession. So bare rock, some lichens are there on it, and then there is some decomposition activity occurring, because of which some grasses are grown, and then some trees are grown, small bushes are grown, shrubs are grown, and then a big tree. So this is ecological succession. There are two different types of ecological succession. One is autogenic and other is allogenic. Let's understand what is allogenic. Allogenic is a change that is brought by the outside forces, like some kind of a bird, by pollination it has come from outside, it has dropped a seed in your location, and then the succession is happening. That is what an allogenic, from the outside force. The bird, which is acting as a pollinator, has generated new kind of forest vegetation in the location. Whereas the autogenic is nothing but a change that is brought within the living community itself. In the sense, like, there are already some seeds or germination of the seeds in the within the location, or the species that exist in the location itself give birth to a new kind of a vegetation in the location. That is auto. So auto is within the community itself. Allo is outside the community. So autotrophic and heterotrophic succession is another two different kinds of successions. Very autotrophic, by the name itself, autotrophs are the plants which have a major greater quantity in number that will have a succession. On the other hand, heterotrophic is nothing but, by the name itself, heterotrophs are these species which will have their nutrition or energy derived from the autotrophs. So when these heterotrophs, like sheep or goats and all these animals which will have their food derivation from the autotrophs, will be more in number, that is heterotrophic succession. So that those are the two differences. Let's see some of the examples, practice questions from the previous years. Which following the items describe not only the physical space but also functional role? So physical space, had it been the physical space itself, it is an habitat. Whereas it is also saying that it's not just physical space but also the functional role, then the answer would be ecological niche. So the next session, till now we have dealt all these basic concepts like ecotone, ecocline, then we have seen some of the ecological successions concepts and all that. So next session, the major ones, which is the most important, that is the energy flow, food chain, food web, ecological pyramids, and how pollutants and trophic levels, bioaccumulation, biomagnification, all the concepts will be dealt with it. So stay tuned. Until then, please like, share, subscribe, and give your valuable feedback and how you're liking the series and how you want me to modify it, or what other series you want me to come up with. Before I end this session, do check out the PGP program, which is a new trademark in the session itself, because the daily online study plan, wherever, in whichever corner of the country you are, you can prepare very well with a contentment that you have a strategy, you have a plan, daily timetable, individual customized study plan where the preparation is totally different from each of the individuals. A mentor will constantly guide you, like a Arora sir, who will be guiding you every step by step by giving you all the answer writing technique skills, all the kind of information, all the material support, everything will be provided. So please do check out and do contact us on this phone numbers as well as the mail IDs for the further details. So until the next session, Jai Hind.